Corporate accounts payable, Nina speaking. Just a moment. 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 Corporate accounts payable, Nina speaking.
Okay, this is On Hold with Atchka. That's the name of my blog, so I should have told you that. I'm speaking with Linda Bacon, Dr. Linda Bacon. She's a nutrition professor at the biology department at City College of San Francisco, as well as an associate nutritionist at the University of California, Davis. And you have a background. Your doctorate is in physiology, specializing in weight regulation, and you also hold degrees in psychology, specializing in eating disorders and body image and kinesiology. How do you pronounce that? Because
kinesiology.
See, I'm showing my ignorance here. So you are best known for your study in the Journal of American Dietetic Association from June 2005, which had the groundbreaking study about health at every size. As well as the book, Health at Every Size, which I apologize, I have not had the chance to read yet, but I am looking forward to it. I've asked for it for Christmas, so hopefully I will get it then. So in a nutshell, how would you sum up that study? Because it's incredible what you've shed light on.
Right. Well, as you know, there's a huge quest for weight loss out there, that people feel desperate to lose weight, whether it's for cosmetic reasons or because of all of the health warnings that we've been getting. And most people spend much of their lives scared of food and trying to diet and trying to lose weight and get on this roller coaster of losing weight and regaining weight. And in our study, we just tried to help people to get off that roller coaster. And the idea was just to tell them, hey, this is the body you've got. Let's just enjoy it and support it and make good choices that respect it. So instead of focusing on losing weight, we just encouraged people to figure out how to appreciate their bodies and found lots of great ways to support them in doing it. And instead of fighting their bodies all the time, to trust that their bodies would do a good job of taking care of them. So we supported them in paying attention to things like hunger and fullness, as opposed to trying to follow some kind of dietary rules. Mm-hmm. And in terms of the activity component, we just supported people in finding ways of moving that were fun for them, rather than just going to the gym or going for a long walk. And to expand their whole idea of what active living could be. And the results that we found from the study were absolutely phenomenal, that at study end, people were, for the first time in their lives, really enjoying food. You know, they weren't scared of it anymore. And they found that when they indulged themselves, they were able to make really good choices and that they could stop when, you know, they were getting various cues that it was time to stop, so they weren't doing as much overeating as they'd been doing previously. And the idea of knowing that no foods were off limits, that they could actually enjoy the foods they love instead of thinking of diet foods all the time, freed them to be able to just eat moderate quantities and not binge. Mm-hmm. And so they had a great relationship with food, and they also just were finding ways to be more active and found that when they stopped looking at activity as kind of punishment for weighing too much or something they needed to do to burn off the calories, that there was a whole different attitude they cultivated, and they could actually find fun ways of moving and really creative ways, which we can talk about if you're interested.
Sure, yeah.
But the overall idea was that these women ended up feeling so much better about themselves. And you know what? There was also a huge payoff in terms of physical health. Blood pressure improved, cholesterol levels improved, all of the measures of self-esteem, depression improved. It was really quite phenomenal. And what was really interesting was that we compared this to what happens in a traditional diet program. So we had a control group of people that were told the usual things, like that, You know, they should moderately restrict their diet. They should exercise 30 minutes a day. You know, they were given all the standard recommendations. Mm-hmm. And what we found was in the control group, the same thing happens that always happens. In the beginning, things were looking great. They were losing weight. Their health parameters were improving, and they were really gung-ho. They had a lot of hope and excitement in the beginning. But then you looked at those women in the control group over time, and they couldn't sustain it. That everything returned to baseline or got worse when we looked at them 2 years later. So, you know, and their self-esteem had really plummeted because they felt like failures. So it was in incredible contrast to all of the wonderful benefits that we were seeing in the group that we called the Health at Every Size group.
Okay. So what was happening before Health at Every Size, before this study, and when the dieting paradigm was the primary one? Why were people failing so much? Was it just that pressure to succeed that was doing it, or how is it making? Why do people fail on diets? Why is it so unsuccessful?
Sure, I'd be happy to respond to that, but I have to say that I'm kind of laughing, and you know, I appreciate how you frame it as if it's past tense that people are dieting, and that's an old paradigm. Because unfortunately, you know, as much as I would love to see Health at Every Size adopted by everybody, unfortunately, it's still considered alternative, and you know, dieting is still the norm and what gets encouraged in the
right.
medical community. Which, to me, is absolutely appalling, because we should be evidence-based at this point. And we have so much evidence that dieting doesn't work. You know, for all of the decades that we've been doing this, first off, you can see the trajectory that the more people diet, that more people are dieting now than ever before, but yet weights have been increasing steadily during the time that people were dieting. So we can see that it hasn't been effective from that perspective. But also, when you look at all the individual diet studies, they're showing that, sure, just about everything shows short-term weight loss, but then whenever the studies look at things on a long-term basis, they find that people regain the weight. And here's what's really interesting, is the studies find that people regain the weight not just if they jump off the bandwagon because they can't sustain it, which, you know, is the assumption, but they're also regaining the weight when they continue in their habits.
Really?
For example, there's a lot of research studies that have looked at women dieting. Like, for example, the largest study ever conducted by the United States government on dieting was called the Women's Health Initiative. And they found that 8 years later, the women were still doing a good job about restraining their eating, and they were eating about 350 calories less than they were when they started the study. So they kept up their diets the whole time. And even then, they found that the women regained the weight that they initially lost in the study. There have also been several studies that have looked at exercise and found the same thing. They had people coming into the gym, and they could measure them on the exercise equipment. So it wasn't just self-report. They knew that they were actually keeping up the exercise program that they started. And what they find is in the beginning of the exercise program, people lose weight. But then there's this point where, despite continuing the behavior that's recommended, the weight regain happens for most people. So we see that practically. And then in the laboratories, we can start to study what's going on. And what we see is that when people lose weight, it triggers some compensatory mechanisms inside your body where your body tries to get you to regain weight. And this is just a biologic phenomenon. Our bodies try to achieve what we call homeostasis of a lot of different variables. So you think about something like temperature regulation, right? Whenever you get too cold, you notice that involuntarily you start to shiver because it's a way of generating heat and getting your body temperature back where you want it to be. And so your body has all kinds of mechanisms to keep your body temperature in control, to keep your blood sugar levels at the right level. And it also has a lot of mechanisms to keep your body fat levels at an appropriate and healthy level. And in the laboratory, we can see that when people diet, their metabolism slows down. So what that means is their body just says, wow, you know, they're putting less energy into the body, so I'm just going to use less energy and try to compensate for it. So physiologically, we know that dieting makes absolutely no sense. There's no reason why it should work based on what we've discovered in the laboratory. Yet we still keep encouraging it.
Hmm. Now, you said that the body responds, it wants to keep your weight at an appropriate and healthy level. And is that genetically based, that level, or how does the body regulate that? And also another, well, I'll throw two questions at you at once. I've also read that as you put on weight, as your weight goes up, that it's, you know, as you said, it's harder to take it off. Does that level increase if you put on weight, or like in your case, you lost weight when you practiced health at every size, without trying? How is that level set? How do you reach that level?
Okay, so lots of questions in there. So let me start from the beginning.
Okay.
It is both genetic and affected by lifestyle choices.
Okay.
So what that means is that everybody comes into this world with a predisposition to carry a certain amount of body fat and in certain places. And then what you do in your life affects that. So, for example, there's a group of people that are the Pima Indians that used to live in Mexico, and they have a strong genetic predisposition to store body fat really readily. But what's interesting is that when the Pima Indians lived in Mexico and they had a lifestyle where they were eating mostly whole foods, they were farmers, and they were eating off of the land, and they were getting a lot of exercise in their work, the Pima Indians in Mexico were all quite slender. Now, because of some really despicable politics that happened, the Pima Indians ended up losing a lot of their land, and half of them relocated to a place in Arizona. And in Arizona, they had a very different lifestyle. And now they were no longer getting as much exercise. Now they were eating a lot more fast food instead of whole foods. And what we find is that the Pima Indians there, like, I think 80% of them are quite fat, whereas in Mexico, none are fat.
And this is the point of the interview in which my recorder crapped out, batteries died, and then continued to flash low battery for the next 4 to 5 hours, therefore pissing me off in incredible ways that I cannot even put into words. So let's take a moment and spread a little Christmas cheer.
I think it's kind of hot to be wearing these scarves in here.
Oh, yeah. Well, the scarves are a must. You can't go caroling without a scarf. Catch your death.
Man, you were like one of those kids I remember in high school that used to sell the most candy bars for the marching band.
Yeah, you'd be president of the swing choir, too.
Definitely.
Thanks, Joe Robinson. Thanks, Tom Servo.
What a kiss up this guy.
Okay, now, if you'll all look at your sheet music, we can rehearse my new song.
You wrote a Christmas song?
Hey, there's no tradition like a new tradition.
Wait a minute. Let's have a Patrick Swayze Christmas?
Yeah, based on my favorite movie, Roadhouse.
Come on, what the heck does Patrick Swayze have to do with Christmas?
Hey, you keep Christmas in your way and let me keep it in mine, okay?
Oh, jeez.
Come on, sir. It seems like a nice enough sentiment. We can give it a shot. Come on.
All right, okay. 12-8 time, uh-huh. Key of A flat major.
Oh,
Cambod, shoot him the tune. Okay, you'll just have to stay with me, everybody, okay? Your parts are written out. Let's have a Patrick Swayze Christmas. By Crow T Robot.
Paul, let's have a Patrick Swayze Christmas.
Right. Hit it, Cambot.
Oh, I start. I get it.
I'm sorry.
Okay, pick it up. Open up your heart and let the Patrick Swayze Christmas in.
We'll gather at the roadhouse with our next of kin.
Not bad.
And Santa can be our regular Saturday night thing.
We'll decorate a bar stool and gather round and sing. Oh, let's have a Patrick Swayze Christmas this year.
Or we'll tear your throat out and kick you in the ear.
Hold it, Cambot, stop it. Kroll, I don't know if I think this is an appropriate sentiment anymore for Christmas.
Hey, what, like a good action sequence don't belong at Christmas?
Well, no, it's just that I've never heard of an action sequence in a Christmas carol before.
Yeah.
Well, then grab hold of your socks and read on, Joel Robinson.
Okay, pick it up from measure 20, Kamba. Lovely intro, though. Very tasteful.
Thank you.
I like that. It's my way or the highway this Christmas at my bar.
I'll have to smash your kneecaps if you bastards touch my car.
I got the word that Santa has been stealing from the till.
I think that that right jolly old elf better make out his will.
Oh, let's
have a Patrick Swayze Christmas one and all. And this can be the haziest. This can be the laziest. This can be the swayziest Christmas of them all.
La, 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 la.
How long before it becomes a standard?
I think you gotta come with me. Come on.
We'll be right back. Save a leg for me.
Okay, well, we're back with Dr. Linda Bacon, the Health at Every Size pioneer. I re-listened to the interview where my self-inflicted technical difficulty occurred, and you were speaking about the Pima Indians and how the ones that had moved to Arizona and kind of picked up the American lifestyle, I guess, had their genetics kicked in, and they stored fat and became pretty heavy, while the ones that stayed behind, was it New Mexico?
No, in Mexico itself.
Mexico itself. And the ones that stayed behind were relatively lean due to their lifestyle there. And I think you were explaining how the genetics worked in that aspect, and, you know, has there been studies on whether the Pima Indians were still healthy the ones that moved to Arizona?
There were, and I'll get to that in a minute. But before I get there, I just want to correct a little mistake you made when you were introducing me. You introduced me as one of the pioneers of the Health at Every Size movement.
Uh-huh.
And while I'm certainly a huge advocate of the Health at Every Size, I'm not sure I'd call myself a pioneer. HAES has been around for decades, and there are a lot of people that came before me that started the movement and have helped to keep it strong. So there's a huge movement that's happening, and I think I'm just one small part of it. But that's a sideline. Back to your point about the Pima Indians.
Okay.
No, we found that the Pima Indians were actually not just genetically predisposed to store fat under certain conditions, but also to, they were genetically predisposed to type 2 diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are extraordinarily high rates of type 2 diabetes among the Pima Indians that adopted the American lifestyle.
Now, was that... Here's where there's a lot of arguments and sticking points is does obesity cause diabetes or does diabetes cause obesity? You know, there's...
Right. Well, actually, I think it's circular that both contribute to one another.
Mm-hmm.
But I also am not so sure that it's a very important question to be asking, and here's why I say that. We don't have a clue how to help people to lose weight.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's that whole fantasy that if everybody either restricts their calories or exercises more, that physiologically it's supposed to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But that's just not what the research is showing, that once people put on weight, they defend that weight. And for some people, it might not be physiologically possible to lose weight. So So even though I'm sure that to some extent weight does contribute to type 2 diabetes, although I think the causality is stronger in the other direction, that the disease process of type 2 diabetes causes people to store fat. Mm-hmm. But anyway, even though it is true that to some extent fat will worsen or cause type 2 diabetes, you know, one of the contributors, telling people to lose weight or admonishing them for being too heavy is not helpful. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, we certainly know some very clear ways to prevent, reverse, or help mitigate the problems around type 2 diabetes, and that's lifestyle change. Mm-hmm. Now, weight loss sometimes is a side effect of lifestyle change, but not always. Mm-hmm. So rather than asking the question and getting down on people because of their weight, I think it's much more helpful to be practical and to look at what can we do to help people. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it really comes down to changing stressors in people's lives, and, you know, helping support them being more active and eating well. And all of these things can have a fairly dramatic effect on type 2 diabetes.
And it's amazing. I've been thinking about this. The message that you're promoting is akin to what we're kind of hearing from the media, and that's eat well and move. The only thing that you're doing differently is saying don't stress about the weight.
Exactly.
So it seems like it would be a small leap to, you know, change the cultural paradigm right now.
But. Well, I mean, I think it's wonderful that you're saying that, Shannon. you got the essential point here. I mean, we all want people to live healthier lives, and we know some of the basics of how to achieve that, as, you know, as you're mentioning, eating well and exercising regularly, and also things like reducing stress or figuring out better ways to manage the stress in our lives, mm-hmm. more friendships, more social support, those kinds of things. And dealing with the social inequities that we have in our system. All of these are important aspects of helping support people in getting healthier. Mm-hmm. And all of those changes can be made just directly, you know. We don't have to use weight as a mediator. Mm-hmm. And what we find is this benefits everybody, you know, that thin people don't benefit when the message is just about weight. Then they think they can, you know, that their eating habits don't matter at all.
Right.
And fat people don't benefit from getting stigmatized and feeling bad about themselves. So really what you're saying, I think, is the essential point. It's like we don't have to, the main public health messages about healthier lifestyles can stay intact. It's just the intent and the motive and how to go about it gets changed. You do it just for the sake of good health, not for weight change.
Well, I have another question about your initial study. It said that there were 78 women that began the study, and 38 came for the follow-up. What happened to the other 40? I'm just curious.
Oh, there were two groups, and so we separated them into two groups of 38. One was a control group where they did the traditional recommendations mm-hmm. to diet and exercise, and the other half went into the health at every size group.
Oh, but I thought I had read that only 38 were involved in the follow-up. Was that
well, actually, you might have looked at the data more recently than I have. I'm not sure of the exact number that came to the follow-up. But, yeah, a lot of people, you know, over time just, like, for example, half of the diet group had dropped out, and so they didn't really have much commitment to coming back and, you know, participating in the testing. So over time, we did lose some people.
Okay. Have you considered doing another follow-up with those same women and seeing where they're at today?
We'd love to, but it's really quite an expensive project.
I can imagine.
And quite time-consuming. So it's not in the works right now.
Okay. Now, you've had another study that recently came out just in November. Where you studied, I wrote it down, and now basically studied the same people, and then you also studied a third group.
Actually, I think you're confusing me with somebody else.
Because, really?
No, I haven't published anything recently.
Oh, okay, great.
But I'm But that's okay, Shannon, because I'm really excited to report that there are a lot of other people that are doing Health at Every Size research right now.
Right.
And it's very exciting to see. There was just a study that was published, for example, in the Journal of the American Dietetic Association by a group in Canada. And they saw phenomenal results, basically very similar to the results that I saw in my study. So we're getting more and more support for this.
This
literature.
Oh, I'm sorry. This may have been the same one. They had a third group that was they were in a social support intervention group, and the social support intervention group did comparably to the Health at Every Size group, and once again the dieting group kind of just fell off the map. So I thought that was really interesting.
Then I don't think that was the group that I'm mentioning in Canada. I'm not familiar with what you're talking about.
I'll have to look that up. I swear your name was attached to that. That's so bizarre. Okay, I'll have to look for that. I have a question. I want to play a devil's advocate and be a skeptic here for a minute. My wife and I have been discussing Health at Every Size, and she's skeptical of it, or she was. The more we talk about it, the more we're seeing eye to eye on it. But the idea that there's no such thing as benign obesity, that having the fat present in your body is still a danger to your health, regardless of what's happening, like visceral fat.
I think that you're misunderstanding Health at Every Size. Mm-hmm. Not everybody's in a healthy body. For some people, the weight that they're carrying is not healthy for them.
Mm-hmm.
That's acknowledged. And the only thing the Health at Every Size movement is saying is that let's keep our focus on good health behaviors and let the fat fall where it may. And that when people have healthy behaviors, their weight tends to stabilize in a place that's right for them. But certainly not everybody is at a place where their weight is healthy, and for some people, weight is contributing to health risk. But certainly we know that weight has very much been exaggerated as a health risk. The majority of people are not experiencing negative effects from their weight, despite what medical authorities are telling us, which is not to say that everybody isn't. Some people are. Yes.
Okay. So now let me ask you this again real quick. Are there instances where a person's weight that you would say something like weight loss surgery, bariatric surgery would be necessary it's being used cosmetically a lot?
Personally, I have never seen a time where I thought that bariatric surgery would be valuable for improving one's health. You start off with a healthy organ, healthy functioning digestive tract, and the whole purpose of bariatric surgery is to make it diseased, to damage it in some way, so it can't do its job properly. That way you don't absorb nutrients in your body and you're not putting more energy on your body. So it seems crazy to me that in today's day and age that we actually think that it's okay to create disease. Especially since obesity itself is not a disease. So, I think that there's always other ways to address things that are much more healthy. And what we see is in medical science, what you usually want to do is you want to think about what the risks are of where somebody is right now. Think about the risks of surgery and whether the odds are that they're going to end up better. And what we see is that the risk of people dying from obesity is really, really quite low. That the association is not very strong. But on the other hand, the risks of dying from the surgery are actually quite high, higher than any risk that might be associated with the obesity itself. So when you do the cost-benefit analysis that scientists are supposed to be doing, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever to introduce this kind of disease in people.
Okay.
And it's also interesting to see, too, that There have been a few longer-term studies done around weight loss surgery, not many, which I think is telling. But in the ones that they're doing, they're finding long-term weight regain, just like they're finding in dieting.
Right.
It happens over a longer period of time, but it happens. So it's interesting that it doesn't even seem to help people to maintain weight loss. It just works a little bit longer than a diet would, but it's still we see that weight regain happen.
And that's more damaging than anything, is the constant flux of weight going up and down with your weight.
Yes, exactly.
That does incredible damage. And is the science stronger to say that the yo-yo dieting, the repeated regain and loss cycles, is that science pretty solid in the health effects of that? Or is it a correlation type thing like people are still using with obesity?
There's not too many ways that you could measure that directly.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that there is very strong strong reason to be able to read the research and see the damage that it does. And you could just think about it with something like your blood vessels, that if your blood vessels expand and contract and, you know, keep changing size like that, you end up doing micro damage to it. And then it's a lot easier for fats that are in your bloodstream to latch on to the blood vessels because they're little micro tears, and so it's easier for it to bond and stick there and for atherosclerosis to build up. So we can understand some physiologic mechanisms of why it would cause the problems that it does. So I think it provides support for the associations that we see.
Okay. And speaking of physiological mechanisms, I'm not science prone at all. I've forgotten everything I learned in high school. And when my wife, we were talking about this, and she was explaining some of the health risks of obesity, something she brought up was that, if you are bigger, if you are obese, that your body has to pump blood to more parts of your body, and therefore your heart has to work harder overall.
Isn't that an amazing thing? That's what we try to do in exercise. We try to get people to get their heart to work harder. And then that strengthens it so it can be even more powerful and keep you healthier.
So it's like, so, it is like, it acts like a muscle.
Well, your heart is a muscle.
Right.
Yes. But my point is that stressing the heart is not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, that's what we try to do in exercise, is we try to stress different parts of our body, make them work harder, and then they develop stronger. So I don't know that that's necessarily a bad thing. That might be why obesity is good for people in some ways. And I'm surprised I actually used the word obesity. I try to stay away from that.
I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah, which I'll explain in a minute. But when you think about something like osteoporosis is a huge problem here in the United States. 50% of all Caucasian women are going to get it. It refers to when your bones get weak,
mm-hmm.
and so then you're very susceptible to bone breakage.
Mm-hmm.
And we know, of course, that a lot of women as they age are really vulnerable to this. Well, heavier women are much less vulnerable to osteoporosis because they have more weight, and the weight causes their bones to remodel, to get stronger, to support the larger weight. So it's a very healthy, positive thing that protects them against osteoporosis. So that idea of stressing the body, in some instances, it's a really phenomenal, healthy adjustment.
And so is that part of the reason why people in the overweight BMI category, and I apologize for using the vocabulary, It's just it's easier for me to express it this way until I learn better. But is that why people who are in the overweight category have longer lifespans than people in the normal category? Is that part of it?
Nobody can really explain that. Mm-hmm. Explain because the epidemiologic research that tells us that people who are in the overweight category live longer. Mm-hmm. Doesn't show cause and effect. It just shows that there is an association. Mm-hmm. So no one can answer the question of what actually explains it. But I would suggest that really the issue is that weight doesn't play as big of a role in our health as we've been led to believe. Mm-hmm. And particularly for people that are in that overweight category, it's not the weight that they're carrying isn't damaging to them. But I also would like to suggest that there are certain lifestyle habits that both encourage weight gain and also support disease. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if you never get any exercise, you may be more likely to store fat more readily. Mm-hmm. And not to burn. To use your body fat. And at the same time, it's also a setup for a lot of different disease processes to happen. You know, your cells might become a little less sensitive to insulin if you're not stressing them out and exercising. Mm-hmm. And, you know, causing that insulin system to work more efficiently. So sometimes, you know, it's the behaviors that then have a side effect of both disease and weight gain.
So are you suggesting that, and this is something I've considered as well, so I'll back you up on this. are you suggesting that all the studies where, you know, obesity causes cancer, obesity causes this, obesity causes that, it's more likely that it's lifestyle is causing this, and the people with these lifestyles, the sedentary lifestyles, who are more prone to weight gain, they're the ones that are more prone to these diseases, not the fact that they're overweight, but the fact that their lifestyle is not healthy?
Well, I would qualify that.
Okay.
I would say that for the most part, that's true, that sometimes lifestyle behaviors cause both weight gain and disease. Mm-hmm. But I also just want to caution you that you can never look at anybody and make an assumption that they have poor lifestyle behaviors, that there will be plenty of people that are quite fat but are eating really well and exercising regularly. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, there are people that are quite fat that are eating poorly. Mm-hmm. And similarly, you could say the same thing about thin people. There are some thin people that have lousy eating habits, mm-hmm. but they have mechanisms in their body, like they might have a lot of this stuff called brown fat that they were just genetically predisposed to have. And their brown fat's really metabolically active, and whenever they overeat, it gets triggered and turned on and just burns off that extra energy. And so they're eating the same quantities and crap that, you know, another person eats, and they don't gain weight from it, whereas someone else would get quite heavy from that.
So that's what some doctors have referred to as internally obese. I mean, even though
I haven't actually heard that term, internally obese.
I may have just made it up. I don't know. But so let's talk about the language. You know, I read your article or the speech that you gave to the National Association for the Advancement of Fat Americans and on thin privilege, and you talked about not using the vocabulary of the people who are promoting this link between obesity and you know, pretty much death is what they're saying. How would you? I mean, do you just use the word fat? Do you believe there should be no categorization of weight, or how do you approach mm-hmm. that issue?
Okay. Well, you mentioned an organization. It's called the National Association to Advance Fat Acceptance.
Dang, I was so close. Yeah.
You were. It's a really wonderful organization. And you notice that they use the word fat in their name mm-hmm. because they're trying to reclaim the word fat. The whole idea behind it is that fat is just another way of being in the world. It's another form of diversity. And we can strip it of its pejorative connotations and just use it as a descriptive term. We know what someone looks like when they're thin. We know what someone looks like when they're fat. And we don't have to have lots of judgment around it. And so that's why they're trying to reclaim the word, just to say, hey, there's nothing bad or wrong about it. And we've seen this before in a lot of other civil rights movements. Like, think about the word queer. The word queer was always used to marginalize people and to say, you know, there's something wrong with you. And when gay and lesbian people stood up and said, no, you know, this is just how I am. It's another form of diversity. And I take pride in it, you know. And I'm not going to be scared of being different. I am queer. And they reclaimed the term, you know, saying there's no reason to think of it as pejorative. It's just who I am. And I think one of the reasons why NASA and other fat civil rights organizations are taking on this term is because we don't have good terms that are out there. That the medical industry has kind of co-opted fat as a bad thing. And they use terms like overweight and obesity. And if you just think of the word overweight, it implies that you're over a weight that is healthy for you, which we know is not true, that the categories that they've come up with just don't make any sense, that there is no weight over which someone is automatically unhealthy. So the term is just meaningless, or I shouldn't say meaningless, it's just wrong. And likewise, if you look at the word obesity and you look at the etymology, it implies that it comes from a large appetite. And again, we don't know this. There's a lot of heavier people that aren't eating, don't have large appetites, aren't eating a lot. And also, they're used as terms to define health. And again, since they don't accurately define health, the categories just get us into trouble. So that's why I try to avoid using the terms overweight and obese, because I feel like they're just an oppressive vocabulary that just assumes disease when there isn't. And I like the idea that NASA has of just reclaiming a term and just stripping it of its power to hurt people.
Okay. That makes sense to me. Two more questions for you. We're almost to that time. First, you wrote an article in November 2006. I hope it was you, but I'm 99% sure. It was "End the War on Obesity, Make Peace with Your Patients," and you wrote this for physicians. And you stressed three things. Weight has been greatly exaggerated as a health risk. To consider morbidity and mortality instead. That sustained weight loss is not a practical goal, nor is it well established to improve health. And finally, that health improvements can result from improved health behaviors regardless of whether weight is lost. How is that received? It's been, you know, 3 years since that came out. How have physicians received that? What kind of response did you receive for that?
Well, it's been interesting because actually that's a really well-cited article, and I just want to bring your attention to the fact that I have done a lot of writing in this field, as you keep mentioning, and I try to make as many of these resources freely and publicly accessible. So people are encouraged, if they'd like to do follow-up on this and find that one article you're talking about, to look at my websites. So I've got one website called lindabacon.org that has a lot of resources like those kinds of writings. And then I also have a website called HAESBook, HAESBOOK.com. And there you can get more information about the book I wrote on this topic called Health at Every Size. And there's a lot of free excerpts that you can download that are short educational tools.
Neat.
You can find videos and, you know, a lot of other resources. And I'm excited to see that these have been well received by physicians. I think that there's, you know, initially it's quite threatening for a physician to be told, you know, your focus on weight isn't helpful. But what I find is that those physicians that are willing to engage actually find some kind of relief when they start to confront these issues. Because one thing physicians really know very clearly is that when they do give the advice to patients to lose weight, it's not well received and it's not it hasn't been successful. And we see so much research that shows that heavier people are avoiding medical visits and delaying medical care because they don't want the weight loss lecture.
Right.
And so I think that doctors are feeling relieved to know that they don't have to give that lecture, that there's another way that can be much more successful and supportive of their patients, and they can partner with their patients better. So I've also, you know, at the same time that the traditional realm is still rebelling against it, I've also found that there's a lot of excitement and enthusiasm, and that this is really a building movement in healthcare right now.
Well, and yeah, it definitely seems like there's a sea change taking place, and I'm glad that you are there, you know, advocating for that. And I have one last question.
Okay, but you know what? Before you get to that question, I want to throw in one more little promotional thing.
Oh, absolutely.
There's a free community website where people can learn about HAES. It's called haescommunity.org. Mm-hmm. And people can wander over there and find tons of resources about HAES and find out about what everyone else is doing as well.
Absolutely, absolutely. And you know, just do the research yourself. Google HAES and try and find as, you know, take in as
exactly.
much as you can. Obesity as a disease. That's like you know, it's kind of a controversial subject, I think. How do you answer people who say that obesity is a disease?
Disease, you have to show disease process, and they haven't been able to do that.
It's
that basic. There are a lot of people that are quite fat, that are in the category we call obese, that don't have any health problems, that are living long, healthy lives. So you can't call obesity itself a disease.
Okay.
Is that what you're getting at?
Sweet and simple. I like it.
Yeah. I mean, it's that straightforward, I think.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you so much for your time. Thank you for putting up with the problems that we had here. You are our initial interview here, so I'm very excited about this. Your book, Health at Every Size, is coming out. You're having a revision coming out also, you say, in pretty soon.
What? I didn't understand that.
You're having a second edition is coming out.
Yeah, I'm really excited that the book is really taken off and is selling well, so publishers got to come up with more copies of it.
Okay.
But there's still a few left, so if people want to get their copies before the holidays, because there might be a little bit of a lag time between editions, but
well,
there are definitely some left now.
It is on my Christmas list. It's on my Elfster list for people to get me that book. I'm very excited about reading it, very excited about learning more about the Health at Every Size movement, and I really appreciate your role in that, and it's been a pleasure and a delight to speak with you.
You too, Simon. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.